For now, we can go ahead discussing some things which are important for us to know in this topic of checklist. I think we covered the last point, the third point as well in the previous lecture, wherein we saw what is a valid judgment and how we can go about using it and how we can make a valid judgment based on the points which are mentioned in the given PPT. Okay, let's go ahead and discuss some of the advantages of checklists. What are the ways by which it can prove to be a beneficial assessment tool for the teachers and as well as for the students? As we all know that checklist is a very simple, convenient and easy to use tool because it doesn't require you to put in that much effort as in comparison to that of rubric, because it definitely consumes a lot of time to develop a rubric if you are doing it the right way. It's convenient because if you know what are the things that you observe in a child, in the children of your class, you can easily chalk those points and convert it into a checklist form. And it's also easy to use because you don't have to rely on the description. Instead, you only have to check whether the particular skill or the particular behavior is seen or not. Yes or no. Okay, so that's very simple. So that makes it a simple, convenient, and easy to use. It provides a very simple method for observation. It seems like data that you would collect using checklist would be very simple. And easy to manage and easy to work with. Third one, it says that they are well structured and easily understood, isn't it? So checklist, since there is not much effort that is required apart from the effort you would put in thinking of which factors or which criteria you would like to assess the child, but otherwise there is no much effort that you need to put in, especially while designing it. So more or less it is well structured. When a person knows how to go about preparing a tool, you can very well make it structured.
Okay. Yes? Ma'am, your voice is cracking in between.
Okay, am I audible now? Hello? Am I audible now? Is it clear? Maybe because of the network issues that we have at our end. Am I audible? Is this issue with everyone?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible now.
Okay, fine. Please let me know, like, at the way just now, if I'm not audible, kindly let me know. Okay, so we can just continue. Okay, so we were discussing about how the checklist can prove to be a very convenient and useful tool. We also saw that how this can help us record observations in a simpler way because there's no much complications involved when we are talking about a checklist, and how it can help us create a well structured, because there's no much technicalities you need to take care of, nor there are any levels with which you have to work. Okay, so it makes it very well structured and it can be easily understood by the students as well as the teacher, and you don't have to put in much efforts for assessment too. So it is one of the most easily understood tools, okay, and which anybody can use at their convenience. Now, the fourth point is they are adaptable to most subject matter areas. Now, when I talk about checklists being adaptable to most subject matter areas, I mean to say that no matter what kind of an assessment I'm planning to do, okay, there will be certain criterions which I will keep in mind while designing a particular task. So even if you jot down those criteria and work on that, then you can easily create a checklist. For that, you don't have to put much stress on how to go about assessment. But that cannot be one of the most reliable tools. But that's not the topic of discussion. Since we are discussing about the advantages, you can make use of checklists for that matter, any kind of subject matter in any field and for any type of a work. So that was the fourth point. Now, going ahead, the fifth point, it says that they are very useful in evaluating those learning activities that involve a product and a personal social judgment. Now, Now it is a bit time to make that checklist a bit narrow. It is time to put it in a very narrow zone, wherein it says that those, it is useful in evaluating those learning activities which involve a product. So when we think of any activity which involves a product, that brings to our mind maybe a project which will make them come up with a product, or it can be any other activity. Like, product need not be something very concrete, it can be also an abstract idea. Okay, for that matter, anything that gives you something, okay, which you can have a look at. Not always, need not be always a concrete thing, it also can be an abstract idea, it can be also an abstract concept. That is also fine. So it basically helps you evaluate a final outcome. More precise term would be an outcome. And a personal social adjustment. Now, this is a bit more specific the way they have put it. But since social adjustment is something which is associated with the affective domain, and as we saw previously as well, that it plays a very important role and it can be used very in order to assess affective domain, anything that is associated with affective domain. So social adjustment is also one of those things. Suppose you are very much aware, does it mean, it means like what is social adjustment and what it means in a way, among your peers, how well you are able to adjust with them when you are to work in group. Such things which can be put under the umbrella of affective domain can be evaluated, very easily using this particular tool, that is a checklist. Okay, so these although this point is not a very broad one, but yes, in a way it tells you a specific aspect of checklist and its advantages, although you can put it in various other forms. It cannot always not be always social adjustment. So in that case, there can be various other topics which can be put under the domain of affective knowledge or affective understanding or affective aspect of an individual. Now, a few more, they are most useful, like in checklists, are most useful for evaluating those processes also that can be subdivided. Okay, previously we saw those which are having some personal domains, like social adjustment is one of those things which we call personal, and which is very much specific to an individual because the level of social adjustment is different for everyone. Okay, so such things, plus in addition to that, also those processes that can be subdivided into a series of clear, distinct and separate actions. So something which is again the same, this point is also heading towards the same direction, wherein it says that it is much easier to use or most useful to make use of these particular checklists when we are talking about a process or some task which can be easily subdivided into various distinct actions. Now, why it is specifically saying or talking about clear, distinct and separate actions? Because each and every action will have a characteristic or behavior to be displayed. So like say suppose I want a child to display a behavior of maybe punctuality, maybe honesty, or maybe, for example, truthfulness, morality. Okay, such things which we can very well categorize into an affective domain, affective aspect of an individual, such things which have a very distinct and clear and a very separate action associated with that particular behavior, then it is easier for a teacher to make use of a checklist because it can help you identify them, identify their absence or presence. Okay, that's why it is said that it is typically linked to a specific behavior. Okay, so checklist and specific behavior go hand in hand, because if you cannot find a specific behavior, if you think that this particular task will not involve any specific behavior and you are doubtful that whether this behavior will be showcased or not, whether it will be hidden, then it is a bit difficult for you to make use of a checklist. But when you are sure that this particular behavior, this specific behavior will be displayed, okay, and it is a very integral part of the project that you are giving, then you can go ahead for a checklist. Okay, and if you even have a 1% doubt that there is a chance that that person or that group might have that behavior or might have shown that behavior, but is not seen or it is not specific, then I think as a teacher should not go for that, because you're designing that group or that particular child of their marks, isn't it? Because if it is not specific, if it is not observable, better not to go for a checklist. And it should have a very clear, distinct action, okay, which is easily identifiable. That's why observation plays a very important role. So that skill should be observable, okay? Now, the next point is, they allow they allow inter-individual comparison to be made, or the common set of traits or characteristics, okay? On a common set of criteria, you can call a common set of characteristics. Now, as I mentioned earlier, that usually, I don't know how it can start the school, but most of what they're doing is, they will suppose that a 10 students in a classroom, they put all the 10 projects, and then they will go through all the 10 projects, and then after going through them, all of them, they will go back and they will see which one was the best, and accordingly, they would allot marks to each one. But as I mentioned earlier, a checklist would not allow you to do that, because you have to consider one child at a time. But here it says that it allows inter-individual comparison. Okay, inter-individual comparison, as in there are two, for a rubric, when I'm using a rubric, or for that matter, any assessment tool, I can assess all the projects which are put in front of me at a time, as in I can assess them together and accordingly a lot more. But in checklist, you cannot do that. But even if you are not allowed to do that, since you have to assess a child based on the presence of a particular characteristic or its absence, you cannot do that. But here it also helps you check which are the characteristics that are present in number one are missing in two. Okay, which are the characteristics which are present in project number three are missing in two, or which are those which are present in four which are missing in the first three. Okay, so that kind of inter-individual comparison is possible based on a set of criteria which we call our observable behaviors. Okay, so please do not get confused here. Now, the next point, they objectively evaluate characteristics, isn't it? Objectivity, which has something to do with telling whether something is there or not there. There is no other way out. There is no subjectivity. Subjectivity is a rubric. Rubric is a subjective tool. Why? Because it has a description, it has different levels. There is no confirmed answer, whether it is, it's an objective kind of a questions when you answer. Either your answer is right or wrong. Okay, but when you answer a subjective question, you cannot be given zero, because you have written something for that given question, isn't it? Similarly, for rubric, you cannot be given zero. You will lie somewhere. Even if there was zero, then you have a certain characteristics, isn't it? That's why you're given that mark, and the description is clearly mentioned in the rubric. For a checklist, it has to evaluate that particular characteristic objectively. That means whether it is there or not there. Okay, there are only two things. Whether it is there, then yes. If it is not there, then no. That's why it is a very objective assessment tool. So that it is not possible to make use of it everywhere. But yes, it is suitable for all the subject matters, but depending on the task also, it would vary. And what justification you are making use of in order to choose this particular assessment tool. But each one of us should know that it is very objective kind of a assessment tool, because there is no other way. It is either yes or no. Now, when a checklist is prepared properly, it helps the observer to direct his attention to clearly specific characteristics. So if you pay attention to it, it revolves around a common word that is specific characteristics. So if you have clearly mentioned the criterions or the criteria on the basis of which you are going to assess a child based on its absence or presence, then it can help you assess the child based on a specific observable characteristic. So that's one of the advantages. If you are not in a position, or if you are not able to set out, or if you are not able to jot down the criteria properly, then it can be a setback, because thinking of a criteria and having specific observational behavioral skills or specific behaviors which you expect a child to display are the basis of this particular tool. So without which checklist doesn't stand its ground, because checklist is used for specific things. If it is there, it is there. If it is not there, not there. There are only two things, yes or no. That's why specified characteristics, clear, distinct, and separate things, observable things are something which you need to have in your assignment or a project. Only then you can make use of a checklist as your assessment tool. Okay, and making those specific characteristics proper, and to make that, and to jotting down the specific characteristics is one of the important aspects of developing any checklist. Without which, your checklist may not be a very good checklist or may not be a standard one. Okay, so these things you need to remember and take care of. Now, going ahead, as we have seen advantages of checklists, as we all know that everything has advantage and disadvantage, so also checklists, isn't it? So checklists, there are also certain disadvantages, some of it we have already discussed while we were interacting about this particular assessment tool. But let us see in detail a few more. Like as I already mentioned, it requires expertise and experience, isn't it? So as I said, like how observation skill is very important and very scientific. It is not just looking or seeing something. Observation is something beyond that, isn't it? So in order to develop a checklist as well, you need that expertise and experience with regard to even developing or writing down those criterions and also making use of it. So for in both the domains, you need that expertise and even the experience. Second disadvantage is which now when you talk about the first one, most of the faculty do not have, because they don't make use of observational skill that easily, and it is not so very common for anyone to have that skill so perfectly. So it's again one of the disadvantage, because expertise and experience is lacking. Now, use of checklist on their own can lead to false sense of security. Now, when I talk about false sense of security with regard to checklist, sometimes when we prepare a checklist for our own work, okay, we only tend to look at certain points which we assume that will be a part of our work. Even for someone else, when you're making a checklist, you work based, or you write down those objectives, or you write down those characteristics or those criteria based on your thinking pattern or your perspective, which may be something broader for the other person, isn't it? Sometimes the teacher even cannot think of certain things which even the students can do. Okay, so in that sense, sometimes it can say, it can give a false sense of security that to a teacher that he or she has done, or he or she has jotted down all the important observable behaviors in the checklist, which are desired or which can be considered as a standard checklist. But sometimes it doesn't happen. Okay, so somewhere or the other, there is a tendency that the teacher might miss out some of those observational skills, observational behaviors, which could have been added to the list. So since it is totally based on how a teacher thinks, or what are the things the teacher is expecting from the student's work, and maybe the narrow-mindedness or broad-mindedness of the teacher would also affect that. So that can be one of the disadvantages of using a checklist, because there is a possibility that some of those important characteristics may not be a part of that checklist also, because since it is a very convenient and easy tool, most of the teachers do not invest much of their time in developing the checklist, thinking that it's very easy. Although it is one of the most difficult ones to do, because you need to identify first which are those tools, which are those characteristics which are observable and which are something or integral part of that particular task. Okay, so that understanding and that false sense of security can lead to a wrong judgment of students' work. So that is one of the disadvantages. And it does not permit the observer to read the quality of a particular behavior, like frequency of occurrence and the extent to which a particular characteristic is present. So here, as I said, it is a bit objective. And there is a lack of subjectivity indeed. So it doesn't allow a teacher to check how well the child, if a child is punctual, to what extent he or she is. There is a clarity to what extent there is a clarity in the concept. If it is neat, to what extent it is neat. Okay, and also the frequency of occurrence, how many times the child did the work properly. Okay, which we could do in other assessment tools or other performance tasks, like if you go for a rubric, so you can actually look at the extent or the frequency of a particular criteria or a behavior, which is not possible in a checklist, since it only mentions as being an objective assessment tool. It says whether a particular characteristic is present or absent in a given task. Now, so these are some examples of two examples we have, I think, to examples like checklists. Your teacher has told you to write a lesson plan. Then consider that I have given you all a book to write a lesson plan, and I have to assess your lesson plan, for which I'm making use of a checklist. So in that sense, it is not a very standard form, but I've just mentioned some of the characteristics or observable behavior or things that I want them to be a part of the lesson. So let us see what are those. Sorry. The first one is set induction. Sorry. The second one is objectives. Third one is development. Then evaluation, etc. When I talk about a lesson plan checklist, so I will be writing whether set induction is written in the lesson plan or not. So I'll have two columns, yes or no. Objectives, second criteria, development, third criteria, evaluation, fourth criteria. So I start to skim through the lesson plans. I will see whether each of these components are a part of your lesson plan or not. And there will be two columns in front of that criteria, which will be yes or no. So if certain induction is a part of your lesson, I will take yes. If you have not written the objectives, I will say no. So accordingly, you can go about checking or evaluating a given task. Okay, I have not given you all a standard or checklist format, but that we'll discuss in the next class, because I need to do with you all about the observation skill as well, although it is not directly a part of your curriculum, but it's very important. It is one of the science process skills also, but it is not very much discussed very much in detail there. So it's better we can learn it in one of the classes which we will be conducting. Okay, and the last example here is a scientific attitude checklist. So you can check for, in order to check a scientific attitude of a person, you can think of one of the criteria that is open-mindedness, objectivity, freedom from belief and superstitions, and belief in cause-effect relationship, accuracy and truthfulness in reporting. So these are some of the characteristics of what you can call criteria or behaviors which you would expect a person with scientific attitude to display. So likewise, you have to give a lot of time in thinking which are those points which you would consider to be a part of a particular task or a project or an activity which you can assess using a checklist. Because you knowing those criteria very specifically, clearly, and which you can mention and describe very efficiently, can only be added to the checklist, without which making use of a checklist would be an injustice to the students, because if a child misses out on something or some of the criteria, then you will deny the child of those marks. Okay, but if you make use of a rating scale for the same assignment, the child can score much better than he or she would when you make use of checklist as one of the assessment tools. So these are some of the things that you need to take care of when you will think of using checklist as one of the assessment tools. We have discussed in that what is a checklist, what are the things that you need to take care of while preparing or designing a checklist, its advantages and also its disadvantages. Okay, so example.